That's too much sauce. Protect your elite to play with. That's too much sauce. Hermes in the aim. That's too much sauce. They let me know before I was famous. I had
and now, it's time for two-time Super Bowl champion, former Pittsburgh Steeler, Ike Taylor, and sports columnist extraordinaire, John Harris. It's the Ike Taylor Show on theairnetwork.net.
Hey, welcome, welcome, welcome to the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. I'm John Harris. As always, with two-time Super Bowl champion Ike Taylor of the NFL Network now. And Ike, how you doing, man?
Man, long time no hear, John, right?
I know, we missed you, man. We missed you. But, you know, we've been thinking about you. We're glad that things are going good with the family. I know you're doing some things on the personal side with the family. We're glad you were able to take care of that. We're always there with you. We missed you, though. We missed you big time, man. There's a lot of stuff to talk about with the Steelers, of course. But the first thing I wanted to talk about, dude, was, you know, turn on, you know, my son always watches the games. I don't always watch them Monday night. And I had the game on and, you know, turned it off. And I kind of put the NFL Network on, just left it on. And lo and behold, I see Ike Taylor on after the game, you know, breaking it down, chopping it up. And I really enjoy watching you on that. It's incredible. You're so comfortable there. And talk about that new. You've moved away a little bit from what you've been doing in the past on the NFL Network. And now you're doing the live action. You're doing an analysis. I mean, your growth, your evolution at the network, really impressive. Just talk about how things have been going with you that way.
So it's been digital. So I've been doing digital since I've been at the network.
Yeah.
Now I'm doing more live TV at the network. So the transition for us, like from football to television, I definitely can't complain about it, John. It's something I never could imagine, if you know what I'm saying. So I guess the producers and my bosses and everybody else, they just comfortable with me being on live TV, but heck, I'm comfortable myself on being on live TV because I'm myself. I always told everybody who was at the NFL Network, it's one thing I can't change, that's change of being me. Like, now, if you ask me to tweak something, I'm definitely going to tweak it to help myself and the viewers who can understand me. Before, it's like me just changing my personality and trying to be somebody else. That's something I can't do. So I feel like, just on TV-wise, John, everybody just look at me, it's like, okay, this guy is all the way authentic. Like, you know, he ain't trying to be somebody else. He's being himself. He's very insightful and funny at the same time. So, you know, that's just a critic of me just, you know, just being myself. So I'm just trying to lay the foundation and the bridge for anybody else who don't use more than 8 syllables in a word. who ain't got all the fancy antics and describing, who just know themselves in the sport they love and can talk about it to a 5-year-old or somebody who's 65 years old. So I think my best attribute is breaking down plays and describing what happened to somebody who's young in age and somebody who's, you know, elderly in age. So I take pride in that. But, you know, that comes along with watching tape and everything else. Well, do I have a lot to grow? Heck yeah, man. I feel like I got to grow every day. But just me, you know, feel like I got to prove everybody wrong. Like, I feel like I'm back on being a rookie in football. You know, just going 4th round.
Yeah.
Only played 1 year cornerback and got to prove to everybody. I feel the same way with the NFL Network. Like, it's a lot of people who went to school for this. And it's not easy, John. Like, doing this is not easy. It's not easy at all. So, I mean, you see Hall of Famers who get the opportunity, but they can't manage to do it for a year, let alone 6 months. Because you not only got to know about your team, you got to know about all the 31 other teams and what's going on in the NFL. So that Hall of Fame status, you know, playing football, yeah, can only get you in the door as far as like being an analysis or football player.
Right.
Once you become, you know, analysis on TV, you got to do your homework and know about everybody. And that's what I take pride on and knowing is using my eyes and understanding the concept of 32 teams, offense and defensive wise.
Well, the thing I seem to think about, the hard thing, radio, a lot of people can go on and do radio. It's easy to talk. But when you're on the TV, it's different. You got the lights on you, in your face, the camera. You're aware of the fact that now you're like on scrutiny, you know, spotlight. But I guess as a professional athlete, being in the spotlight definitely prepares you for it. But even once you get past that, then you kind of have to be natural. And that's hard, but you're natural. You're who you are on the camera. You're not like trying to change, or like you say, be this certain person, be this TV person, this talking head. You're able to translate what you've done, who you are, your personality, and as a football player, that's now being seen on TV. And that's not an easy thing to do, because it's hard to be natural like that, but you're natural. It looks easy for you. It just looks like you're just being Ike, and you're not trying to force something or be somebody that you're not.
And that comes from production, your producers, yeah. John. Like, I got a few producers from digital and, you know, the TV network. Like, man, I don't want nobody but you. So they feel like, man, I can have 100,000 robots. I can groom 100,000 analysis and being a robot into somebody I want to be. But
yeah,
one thing about you, Ike, is you're you, and that's unique. You're charismatic. You got a certain personality. You got great character, and you relay the message. So everybody can't do that. So I'm not changing what you do best, which works for TV, but letting you be you. But I'm telling my bosses, like, I ain't changing anyway. Huh. Like, I'm not going to let you change me. So I'm going to give these people, meaning viewers, fans, I got to give them my knowledge. I got to display what I know. And I'm going to be entertaining at the same time, John.
Yeah. Well, why would I mean, I'm thinking about it from a TV standpoint. I don't want 100 talking heads. You know what? I don't want 50 former players. I want your personality out there. Yeah, the fact that you're a former player and you can break it down like I can't, because you were out there and you know exactly how it feels to be in a Super Bowl, to win a Super Bowl, to hold that trophy, to flash a Super Bowl ring in people's face, that type of thing, to understand the pressure as a fourth-round pick, not knowing whether or not you're going to make the team. Are you going to get cut? What I got to do to make the team? Coming to a team like the Steelers, veterans, and, you know, and then what, your third year, the veterans going to Bill Cowher, the coach at the time, and saying, put this young buck in at cornerback. We need him to be the starting quarterback this year. And lo and behold, that's the year the Steelers won the Super Bowl. That's not an easy, you went through all those things. So to me, what you're doing now, and I'm not saying it's easy, but the groundwork has already been laid through your whole football career and all the things that you went through and obstacles you had to overcome. And you're just applying that hard work, because you always were a hard worker. Now you're just applying it to TV.
Yeah, I just feel like I'm back at football as a young buck. You know, a young buck meaning my second year. So I still got a lot to prove. And I feel like just in life in general, my life always been like, I got a lot to prove regardless. So I always embrace that, you know. And I feel like, man, I ain't never got to make excuses, because excuses are setbacks. And I don't want a setback. So every day I move, every day I wake up, I look at that as another opportunity. Everybody don't look at waking up as being a opportunity. Hmm. You know, that's why, you know, I promise myself and my family, like, I'm not going to be the excuse guy. I want to be held accountable. I want that load on my shoulders. I want it all. So all that adversity, or everything that comes with adversity, I want that. And a lot of people don't want that,
yeah,
in their life, because there's a lot of criticism. It's a lot of scrutiny that comes with that. But at the same time, man, I'm thinking generation after generation after generation. So I feel like in my mind, I would take all the downfall and all the criticism and all the scrutiny for my generations to be successful or to at least give them a chance in life later on down the years.
You're listening to the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. John Harris with two-time Super Bowl champion Ike Taylor, now the NFL Network. You can catch him Monday nights after Monday Night Football on NFL Network. Check him out. He's doing a great job. We're talking about his TV career. And the other thing I wanted to ask you about, Ike, and it's something that we've noticed, and I've noticed the last year or two on the show that we've been doing, well, going on 77 years now. It's hard to believe. You're a transformation now. You, I always say, you know, two-time Super Bowl champion with the Steelers. You played with the black and gold. Now you're watching them as a former player, but now as a member of the media. And right now that team is going through some struggles. So right. How is it? Is it getting easier and easier for you to look at this team now, even though it's a part of you, it always will? You bleed black and gold in that regard. But now you got to look at them differently, in a sense. Those are your guys, but now you're looking at your guys in some ways in a different way now. Now you've got to break it down and tell the viewers, the audience out there who's watching you and know you played for the Steelers, what's going on with this team? How's that been? You know, how's that been for you?
That's been a transition itself, John.
Yeah.
You know, so just everybody knowing who I played for and who my guys is, but at the same time, you don't want to, you know, be too harsh on your guys, but just from having a job standpoint, you got to tell the people the truth. You know what I'm saying? Whether you're talking about the Seattle Seahawks or the Pittsburgh Steelers,
Yeah. They
got to understand what you see. They got to know what you see. So I think now it's better for me in my second year on just explaining what I see, even from my team, what's right or wrong. As far as like my teammates, former teammates being upset, I'm cool with that. Because at the same time, you're giving me something to talk about. Yeah. So you don't give me nothing to talk about, I have nothing to talk about. You give me something to talk about,
right?
Well, then I can talk about it. So that's how I look at it. But even when I do talk about, you know, something or somebody and it's a bad play, yeah, I make sure from my standpoint, I don't bash a player, meaning I don't downgrade or degrade a player. I say it in a way like, okay, he should have been in this position. He put himself in this position, but he should have finished.
Right.
Instead of saying, oh, this is stupid and this is what he should have did. I stay away from the harsh words because the people who use the harsh words never played. And the people who've played, who've used the harsh words should be ashamed of themselves. That's how I look at it. So it's a way you can get your point across but not using harsh words. And I try to be that analyst.
Okay, so putting on the analyst cap, we saw Sunday's game, huge game for both teams, Steelers, Cowboys. Ended up being the fourth consecutive loss for the Steelers, and again, they really needed to win. How did you break that game down? How do you break that game down as a former Steeler, two-time Super Bowl champion with that team, and as an analyst for NFL Network? What's your take on that game, the good, the bad, and the ugly?
Well, the bad is I think the defense understands, you know, now with a pretty smash mouth offense with the Dallas Cowboys, you can't play 58 minutes of the game. It truly got to be a 60-minute ball game when you're playing whomever. The reason why these coaches, you know, simplify the defense, keep going over things, repetition after repetition, the same plays every practice, because they see something. And what they see is the strength to offense or defense. And as a player, when you acknowledge that and see that, you like, okay, I understand, I get it. But when you just keep making the same mistake after mistake after mistake, you know, sooner or later, coaches got to make a coaching change. So it's just been for the Pittsburgh Steelers, from an offensive standpoint, man, they look good at home. From a defensive standpoint at home, it's like, dang, can y'all stop somebody one time? But on the flip side, when we go on the road, it's like on the offense, like, I can't get the same thing or something similar to what we do at home from the offensive side, far as like points wise.
Yeah.
And on the defense side on the road, it's like, okay, you know we're on the road, you know it's gonna be difficult for us. So if you just look at the strength from the Pittsburgh Steelers, is it's the offense.
Yep.
So okay, you're averaging close to 30 points at home. Why not average 20 to 21 points on the road? And that's what the Pittsburgh Steelers offense is enduring right now. You can say what you want to say about the defense. The defense ain't what the defense used to be. All of it now is we want to put up 30 points a game. And we all know the strength is the offense. So until the defense finally come around, because it's still a lot of young talent on that defense. It's still a lot of missing pieces to the puzzle on the defense. Like, far as like being veterans and having the most years on both sides, other than James Harrison, who is now a starter, which he was substituting, and William Gay, who is now, you know, not a starter, but substituting now.
Yeah.
Other than them two guys on having the most experience, Ramon Foster been playing a lot. DeCastro been playing a lot. Pouncey been playing a lot. We can go down the line, like Big Ben, he been playing a lot. Yep. Even though AB in his prime, he been playing a lot. Le'Veon Bell, since he came in the league, he been playing a lot. D'Angelo, you know, Williams, he been playing a lot. So it's a lot of guys on the offense who got a lot of years and experience. You know what I'm saying? So,
yeah.
On a road, too, I need your help. Like, that's how I'm looking at it. So, it's just inconsistency on both sides. As soon as they find that consistency, John, then you're going to see not the old Pittsburgh Steelers, but a consistent Pittsburgh Steelers on a roll or at home.
Here's what I see, dude. I don't, Ben Roethlisberger, you know, has never played better, but I'm a realist, and Ben Roethlisberger is 34 years old. And I'm thinking about Ben Roethlisberger the same way when we used to do it on the show, and I would laugh, and people, when you guys were still ranked number one, I don't know if it was 2011, 2012 in total defense, and local columnists were saying, well, you know, they're number one in defense, but, you know, they don't get enough turnovers. They don't make enough splash plays. And I would laugh, and I say, trust me, they're gonna regret that. They're going to regret saying that, and they're going to remember how good this defense was. I truly believe that the Steelers wasted some potential Super Bowl years, but playoff years with great defenses when the offense didn't do what it was supposed to do. And to me, in a sense, kind of got off the hook. Now what we're seeing is now the offense is the torch carrier, and the defense is getting criticized publicly. Ben Roethlisberger is 34 years old. His shelf life, it's not that much anymore. It's not that long anymore. So you're talking about a great offense? Well, some of that's being wasted, because guess what? He's not going to be playing forever. So right. In 2 years, if the defense is good, Ben Roethlisberger will be 36. So right. They need it, like you say, they need the defense to grow up right now. And it's going to be hard with Cameron Haywood out for the year now and a young secondary guy still trying to figure it out. That's going to be hard, man. People are really going to have to step up. You know, starting Sunday in Cleveland, that's a must-win game.
Man.
You know.
I mean, I'm looking at what you're talking about. you know, our pass defense since 2004.
Yeah.
2006, 20th. 2009, 16th, which I don't even get. 2010, 12th.
Yeah.
So, 2004, we was ranked 4. 2007, we was ranked 3rd. Right. 2008, we was ranked 1. Yep. 2011, we was ranked 1.
Yep.
2012, we was ranked 1. Okay. So, to Coach LeBeau's defense and defense, run defense from 2004 to 2000, and when did Coach LeBeau leave? 2014 to 13.
2 years ago, yeah, 2 years ago. So
2014?
Yeah, he left. That was his last year, 2014.
Okay, so since 2004 to 2014, only one time on a run defense, Coach LeBeau was ranked in double digits. In 2013, in the run defense, we was ranked 21st. So here's the stats. 2004-1, 2005-5, 2006-3, 2007-3, 2008-2, 2009-3, 2010-1, 2011-8, 2012-2, 2013-21, 2015-6.
Wow.
So, you don't run on Pittsburgh Steelers defense when Dickie was there.
Nope.
Why? Because you have cornerbacks as myself and other cornerbacks that take pride in not letting a running back run on us. Why? What do running backs in a running game do to a defense? It bleeds the clock. It takes pride. It takes ego. You control the game when you can run on a defense. You know? So
yeah.
We took pride in that. Coach LeBeau took pride in having tackling cornerbacks. So everybody got mad at me or a Deshae Townsend or Brian McFadden or Will Gay got mad at us because we didn't have enough splash plays.
Yeah,
because
right.
Because we wasn't getting the interceptions. But when you have corners who don't mind tackling the running back, that's how your running defense become top 5 or top 10 defense other than 1 year out of 12 to 11 years. So all you got to do is watch now what the Seattle Seahawks are doing. And I got Richard Sherman ranked number 2 on my list only because he gave up like 2 touchdowns in 4 weeks, which is rare for Richard Sherman.
Right.
But Richard Sherman, on my top 10 list of corners, is probably the best tackling cornerback. And now you see with a Cam Chancellor, with the healthy Russell Wilson, what it does to a secondary who can tackle. And the reason why I stress tackling is it's a lot of times cornerbacks going to be put in one-on-one situations where you're not going to have help to tackle. Help is going to come late. So you got to be in position to make that tackle. And that's what Seattle does well as a secondary. They tackle to catch well. They tackle running backs well. So I'm looking at it from a distance like, now I see what Dickie was talking about from a cornerback and a secondary standpoint. Like, okay, we ain't getting you the picks. But us not getting you the picks since you the 3 Super Bowls, 1-2. Now, it's a lot of guys and a lot of teams who got picks that haven't won or haven't been to many Super Bowls. I know the Saints for sure got a lot of picks, and they wind up winning the Super Bowl. So I get all that. I know Indy for sure, they really weren't getting picks, but they had Mathis and Freeney, who was causing havoc coming from the edges. Why? Because Peyton Manning in the offense was putting up points, so everybody had to catch up to him. Even as good as Tom Brady is during the regular season, that Patriots offense, they run the ball well during playoffs. You can say what you want to say. They run the ball well during playoffs. They figure that out. And if you want to look at the latest Super Bowl champion, the Denver Broncos, they didn't win it on Peyton Manning's arm. They relied on that play-action pass game / running game solely on their defense.
Yep.
And if you look at what their cornerbacks do, they tackle well. And if you look at the recipe in which GM John Elway looked at, he played Seattle when Seattle spanked them. And he was like, man, I thought it was all the offensive league. And man, Seattle spanked us on defense while we was playing offense. I can't wait till the free agency come because I'm about to do that same thing. And now he reaping the benefits.
So everything you're saying about Seattle, you're not saying about the Steelers. So you're saying stuff by not saying it. And it's funny that you mentioned Dick LeBeau. I talked about him when we did a podcast a couple weeks ago. I wish Dick LeBeau was the defensive coordinator of the Steelers right now. Just go look at Tennessee's stats right now defensively. He's been with them, 2 years now? And he has transformed that defense. That's a defense. If the Steelers had that defense with Dick LeBeau, they would be, oh, my God, with the offense that they have, let's not even go there where they would be. So we could start a whole Hornets nest right there with that. You know, maybe there's some media member in Pittsburgh that'll do it. I doubt it. They're kind of weak. But to me, if you want to start something, that would be an easy place to start. Dick LeBeau kind of being run off. There's no more time there. But the fundamentals and what he brought to that defense with the Steelers for many, many, many years is gone. And whether Keith Butler will be able to bring it back or transform it, I don't know. But they need it right now because that offense is a right now offense. That offense is ready to go right now to win big now. And the defense is not there to complement it. And it's a shame. But you can't help but compare it, Ike, when you look at what Dick LeBeau, who people said was too old, what he's now done in Tennessee. He's got some former Steelers on the team, some former players that are on the team. I think my boy, defensive lineman, I think, is a defensive line coach, former Steeler. What is his name? Who played with you guys for a while. And he's a defensive line coach. So
Nick Eason.
Yes, my boy, Nick Eason. So They're doing their thing there. And I'm happy to see it. Good people. We know all about Dick LeBeau. You know all about Dick LeBeau. It's interesting, though, how things change and how quickly they can change. We're just talking about 2 years here. 2 years. We're going to take a break. You're listening to the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. We're going to take a break. We're going to come back and talk some more defense. We're going to talk about some cornerback play, and we're going to talk all football here on the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network.
Family Center 223 is the heart of the community. Becoming a member of the Huntington Moose enables you to join friends who have served the community for over 100 years. It's the annual canned food drive on Saturday, December 17th, with all canned goods going to the local food bank. Bring a can of food or non-perishable item to the Clifton 5 Theaters for free admission to a movie on Saturday, December 17th at 10 a.m. The Huntington Moose Family Center 223, serving the community with the best value in town. Follow us on Facebook.
Brenneman's Meat Markets are celebrating nearly 70 years in providing Huntington County with quality USDA-approved processed pork, chicken, and beef products. Brenneman's has two locations in the county where the tradition of the finest meats are found in the region. Stop by Brenneman's Huntington weekdays from 8 to 6, Saturdays 8 to 3. Mount Union, open 9 to 5 weekdays and 9 to 2 on Saturdays. Choose specials of $10 to $50 meat packs containing your favorite meats, or stop by and ask about our select custom cuts prepared and packaged while you wait. Brenneman's Meat Markets in Huntington and Mount Union. Call our office at 814-643-2751 for specials and more information.
Grab the Big Kahuna, the 24 square cut pizza with your choice of one topping for only $19.99. Now at All American Pizza and Subs at 612 Washington Street, downtown Huntington. All American Pizza and Subs has delivery, and they're the home of great pizza, subs, salad, wings, and more for lunch, dinner, or a late night snack. Call All American Pizza and Subs right now at 643-0222. Closed Mondays. All American Pizza and Subs. Like us on Facebook.
D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family are committed and dedicated to excellence by supporting quality education and athletics for all youth of Huntington County. For over three generations, D.C. Goodman & Sons and their staff of quality tradesmen have provided excellent service in the installation of plumbing, mechanical and industrial piping, electrical, and fire sprinkler systems. Residential services are also available. D.C. Goodman & Sons and the Goodman family will continue to serve the community, and thank you for your support. The Goodman family wishes you the best to all area students in your pursuit of excellence. And now, back to Huntington.
To the Ike Taylor Show on the airnetwork.net. Here's John Harris.
Hey, welcome back to the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. I'm John Harris with two-time Super Bowl champion Ike Taylor, having a fantastic discussion about the Steelers and defense and all kind of good stuff. And I wanted to keep on this vibe we've got going here, Ike, cornerback play. Been reading some very interesting stories recently about Darrell Revis. And I can remember when he had an island and he could do no wrong. And I'm reading now that he's saying that he's getting old and he has injuries and things just aren't working out right. And no longer does he have an island. I don't know what he has now. But I couldn't help but think about you during that time. He's 31 years old and he's saying he's old. He's getting old. And the one thing about you that you never did, ever, you never alibied, dude. You never made excuses. You never said, I got beat. You know, you never started holding your hammy if you got beat for a touchdown. You faced the music and you dealt with it and you took a lot of heat. I thought a lot of unfair criticism through the years with the Steelers. But I look now at Revis, who to me has lived a charm life. Great player. Had his own island. Many people have said he's the best cornerback. And now when things aren't going well, and he's still getting paid. Now we're trying to kind of, well, why is it not working right now? And it's interesting because one thing I said a long time ago, when you're at the top, there's only one way to go in sports. You go down. And now he's finding that out. And it's interesting just to see time, you know, no one beats Father Time. But dude, this dude's just 31 years old. It ain't like he's 35 or whatever like that. So to me, it's just kind of interesting just the way the whole thing is played out. And I guess how different people are treated or covered in the media. But I can't help but think about how you dealt with a lot of things like that. And you came out because, I don't know, you just something about you, you refused to make excuses. You were willing you would take the blame for other teammates and put it all on your shoulders. And you did it constantly. And it used to bother me. It used to annoy me. But it was just something in you that you were able to do that. Some people can't take any criticism. And Revis seems to be maybe one of those guys because things have been so good for so long, and now they're not. We got to come up with a reason why it's not working.
I mean, Father Time ain't got no picks and chooses on who they, who he creeps up on. So, to Reeves' defense, you got to understand he's dealt with a lot of major injuries. I haven't dealt with a lot of major injuries except for the broken forearm, which I tried to come back on. So, at the same time, it's just like, you know, he's dealt with a lot of leg injuries and being a cornerback. When you start talking about the legs and the ankles and the feet, man, that's a process that can hinder you, especially when you get older. So it can kind of enhance you getting older. So from Reeves' standpoint, just going through what he went through, you know, injury-wise, surgery-wise, I can understand what you're saying, but at the same time, fourth-round cornerbacks only played for 1 year, don't get the chance as a first-round cornerback who is as polished as a Reeves. That's just how the game goes. So I knew from my standpoint, like, for one, just the person I am, I ain't making no excuses. Like, my family, my homeboys wouldn't allow me to make excuses. Like, if I effed up, I effed up. It's on me. And even if I didn't eff up, I take it on me. Because I know I'm playing with a Troy Polamalu, who's a Hall of Famer. A Casey Hampton, who I think should be in the Hall of Fame. A James Ferrier, who was probably one of the hardest hitters. A James Harrison, who was about to pass up the Steelers sack leader. A Aaron Smith, a Brett Keisel, a Larry Foote, who's now the coach, a Deshae Townsend, who's now in position to be a defensive coordinator, who is now working with Coach LeBeau, Chris Hope, who was working under the Tennessee staff. So, a Brian McFadden, who is now on TV and slash digital-wise with Chicago 120.
I check him out. He does a good job on that.
Man, I'm playing with guys, a Nick Eason, who's now the coach. Like, a Chris Hokey, who now doing TV. Like, y'all ain't feeling me when I'm talking about these guys who been successful off the field and on the field.
Yeah.
So, y'all looking for a certain kind of guys, and every guy but a Troy Polamalu has been a first round other than a James Ferrier. So, James and Troy been the only two first rounders on a fire ass defense, on a solid defense, on a defense who broke plenty of NFL records.
Right.
You got two guys who are first rounders and you surrounded by guys who are late rounders. We all understood one thing, and that's loving and playing for each other. So, and Dickie made that possible. Dick LeBeau made that possible. And again, we played for a lot of things in life. Everybody had their own individual goals. But once you met Coach LeBeau, man, you wanted to play for Coach LeBeau because it was his presence. It was a certain way. See, when you get in the Hall of Fame of being a coach and a player, and we vouch for him, and I forgot a Joey Porter, Jason Gilden, a Clark Hagans. I can go on and on. A Ryan Clark, who's now with the NFL, but he's with ESPN. We can go down the line with this shit, John. Like, it don't stop. Like, every guy I didn't name from the defensive side. Usually people who get hired for TV, it's on the offensive side. So this is how I look at it. And I look at it because I have a mentor in Deion Sanders now. Like, he's been teaching me the whole game from a TV standpoint. And he's like, man, our perspective is defense. Our perspective is different on TV. Because, like, if you look around, how many defensive guys flourish on TV? And I'd tell you the same thing, John. How many defensive guys flourish on TV?
That's true.
Not too many.
It's always
a lot of Hall of Fame slash waiting for the Hall of Fame guys or guys who have been productive on offense on TV. You can name a handful of guys who played defense in the NFL who's on TV. So, and that's letting you know how productive, how unselfish our defense was on the guys I just named.
Well, it's not, it's definitely different, but nothing stays the same. I think one of the Steelers' biggest problems is the success that the franchise has had. There really is never room or time to be patient and to rebuild and to let these young players develop. They got to do it right now, you know, and in a lot of cases, it's not possible to happen. So in many ways, the Steelers are victims of their success that this year, people are not going to be patient with the young cornerbacks. They're not going to accept the fact that, you know, Dez Bryant got a 50-yard touchdown pass on them the other day. That's not acceptable, but in a lot of other cases, it's a part of the growth process. But when you're with the Steelers, you know, it's you got to come in and produce now. So you're dealing with all that. You've got a Ben Roethlisberger, a quarterback who's, you know, people are trying to get to another Super Bowl. His time, his clock is ticking. So for these young guys that you have, you know, they have to, you know, they got to do it now. And but I got Greg here sending me something here. So before we take our next break, I want to ask you here. He wants me to ask you. Rookie of the year. I'm changing course right here real quick, but he wants me to ask. So I'm going to get this in before the break. Rookie of the year, Ezekiel Elliott, Dak Prescott. Dak Prescott, who Ike Taylor practically got on his knees and begged the Steelers to draft prior to the draft on his show. And I didn't know who Dak Prescott was. He's talking about Dak Prescott. This kid's something else. He begged the Steelers to draft this kid. Let's not even get into it. Could you imagine if Dak Prescott was with the Steelers? He's not. But you talk about a talent evaluator, a guy that knows talent. Ike Taylor was talking about this guy before the draft and that he was a player that was going to – that had impressed him through workouts with Tom Shaw, the great Tom Shaw down in Orlando at ESPN Disney. And had first up close and personal workouts with him, saw his work ethic, saw his leadership. Those are the qualities that they talk about him now, leadership. Your rookie of the year choice, is it one of those two guys? Is it somebody else? Who would you pick?
Rookie of the year?
Yeah. Or maybe MVP for Elliott. I don't know. Elliott might be MVP.
I'm going to go with a Dak Prescott. And here's why. And a lot of people are going to call me biased, and just because I work with the guy down here at Coach Shaw. And I get it. And I understand why you might think I'd be a little biased, but the people who's listening and understanding is I don't have just one team now. I got to evaluate every team now.
Right, all the teams.
So I'm looking at it like, other than a center, who touches the ball more than a quarterback? So when you want to talk about game-winning drives or coming back to win a game, who's going to touch the ball more than a center other than a quarterback?
Nobody.
Who's going to get an A or an F when it comes down to solidifying them being a franchise player, regardless on who your coordinator is on the field, other than a quarterback?
Nobody.
Who's going to have that poise and make themselves a Hall of Famer or well off after they retire, or how much the teammates love this guy, the teammates sacrifice for this one guy, other than the quarterback? Nobody.
Nope.
So when you look at a Dak Prescott, and all I've been saying is he's the first one to come in, he's the last one to come out, he's poised in a pocket. So yeah, you can talk about, oh, their offense is simple. Well, he makes this offense complicated to cover because he doesn't panic. Regardless on whether it's 15 minutes left in the second quarter or a minute 37 left in the fourth quarter, he's still the same person, if you ain't know by now. Dude. So he's playing better than a lot of veteran quarterbacks. Now, to the Dallas Cowboys defense, running wise, they have no better running offensive line in Dallas than Dallas. Let's not get that twisted.
Nah.
But I'm gonna flip back while putting your pride aside as being the offensive coordinator. So the offensive coordinator, like, look, we don't have Romo, who know exclusively our offense, and the playbook can be as wide as the world. I'm going to go on and simmer this down and rely heavy on this run game, this run offensive line, and I'm going to take a few pieces to the puzzle on what Dak Prescott did at Mississippi State and implement this into an NFL offense, let alone Ezekiel Elliott did the same thing in Ohio State. He flourished well in the shotgun. So I got two people who don't mind being in the shotgun who can be productive, let alone put and establish a Dak Prescott under center and handing the ball off a play action pass and let Ezekiel Elliott get his shoulders square to the line of scrimmage to where he can hit a hole and hit it going fast and not worrying about turning his shoulder pads. So getting back to Dak Prescott, it's like he has the ball the majority of the time when you want to talk about the offense. So why wouldn't a man get the MVP? Of course, Ezekiel Elliott, ain't nobody doing what he's doing. Man, if the man rushed for 1,800 yards, it's like, golly, like, man, the man, a rookie, he ain't even playing the preseason, nope. And he rushed for 1,800 yards. But if you want to talk about Dallas, a.k.a. / America's team, yeah, it took your third-string quarterback to get you to an 8-1 situation. So I'm like, you done had a Pro Bowl quarterback and you never went 8-1. And you gonna be like, well, he ain't got enough game tape. And I'm gonna be like, well, it's enough game tape out there on the Dak Prescott. And since you said the offense so simple, why you can't stop it? Because one thing I do know when they had a DeMarco Murray was DeMarco Murray led the league in rushing.
Right.
So far, so good. Ezekiel Elliott is doing the same thing. The difference is Dak Prescott isn't throwing as many picks as your Pro Bowl quarterback did. So I'm looking at it like he would rather take the sack, he would rather throw it out of bounds than force the ball. So now you look at a veteran guy at the wide receiver position, or Dez Bryant, like, man, I'm used to being the man, because I know when Tony Romo was still, man, I was the man for, like, passing.
Yeah.
But shucks, on the flip side, man, we ain't never do 8-1. But I would rather take 6 targets with 5 attempts and me catching a ball and 2 tubs than 14 targets, 10 attempts of me catching the ball, 150 yards to us losing. He finally get that.
Finally.
It means a lot to him. So now you look at a Beasley, something similar to a Wes Walker, Edelman, and them guys. Like, man, this dude is a hard-nosed slot receiver who can work the chains.
Yep.
And we all forget about the old slowpoke 22-year-old 22-year veteran, and Jason Witten.
Yeah.
Who all they do is catch touchdowns and move the chains also.
Right. So
it's like, y'all know what our game plan is, and y'all still can't stop it. Y'all knew what our game plan was with Tony Romo, and we still found the way to beat y'all. Why? Because when you throw the ball that many times, something bad is going to happen to the offense. If you play 16 games and you throwing the ball 35 to 40 times, not too much good is going to happen to your offense. Quarterback is going to get sacked. quarterback is going to fumble, quarterback is going to throw picks, quarterback is going to get hurt. So you got to complement that with a running game. So when you do that, you find a team who's going to be 8-1. They have an identity. And what's their identity? Running the ball. So their time of possession as an offense is their defense. And how does that help your defense? To some okay guys on that defense, it gives them confidence.
Yeah.
So the more I play, the more I get these three and outs, the more you put that battery pack on me, the more I'm like, you know what? I'm better than what these people from the media have been talking about, because it's proven. And that's what the Dallas Cowboys has as a recipe on the offensive side. It's totally helping their defense, and the defense ain't playing too bad. So when you look at a Dak Prescott and see what he's done, then when you look at a former Pro Bowler and Tony Romo and see his press conference, I can't even BS like the dude been balling, and the dude meaning Dak Prescott. Yep. The young man been balling, bro. Like, y'all been looking for this dude to fail, and he's been looking like a rookie sometimes, but for the majority, he's been looking like a veteran guy, so you can't even knock the dude. That's how I look at it. So I'm like, there you go with the Dallas recipe. And you just got to tip your hat off to Jerry Jones and company, because they went back to the Troy Aikman, Emmitt Smith days. Like, they rely heavy on their run game, play action pass game. And the guy who flourished, who is one of my workers, co-workers, is Michael Irvin. Yep. And Michael Irvin's stats ain't like everybody else's stats. But all Michael Irvin did was catch touchdowns. All he did was Debo people. All he did was run the tough routes across the middle, posts, digs, slants, a few fades. So that's how I look at it, man. They got the recipe to do it. And they playing Seattle. And, you know, a lot of people like Seattle going, you know, put it on them. But I'm looking like, one thing I know about Dallas, they don't fade away from that run game. One thing about that run game, Seattle been having a few problems with their run game. All you got to do is look at that Carolina Panthers game.
Yeah.
So I say stuff and people don't listen. And I don't say it as being a fan, because as a fan, you're going to be biased. On this show, on airnetwork.com, I'm telling y'all need to listen to me. If you don't listen to me for a few minutes, man,
listen.
Just peep your boy out.
Listen to the man. Listen to the man. Listen to the man on the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. Hey, nobody less than Dave T. Thomas, one of the greatest talent evaluators in NFL history, who a friend of the show, who we will be getting on in time. He said that this guy, Ike Taylor, is general manager material. I'm saying it. How did he know about Dak Prescott? How did Dak Prescott make it to the fourth round? Hey, Dallas got lucky. They didn't want him. They wanted that quarterback in the first round who they couldn't get. And they ended up taking Dak Prescott in the fourth round. How does Dak Prescott go to the fourth round? Even a bigger question than that is, how did Ike Taylor know about this guy, Dak Prescott? You want to know the answer, you got to listen to the Ike Taylor Show on the Air Network. He'll tell you why. Listen to him break it down. Listen to him break down the NFL like nobody else can. We're winding down here. I want to touch on, you know, something really. We're going to end up with the Steelers and Browns prediction. It was another big game on Sunday. New England, Seattle. You mentioned Seattle briefly. Is that a Super Bowl preview, or is Dallas going to beat them out? What do you think?
Oh man. That's another preview. That's another preview. But what I'm gonna tell you is, don't be surprised if the Oakland Raiders are in the Super Bowl.
Woo! I like them, young talent. Just don't know if it's too young. I like them.
Nah, it's not too young. because this is how you got to look at it, John. In 2005, they thought the Pittsburgh Steelers was too young also.
Had a first-year starting quarterback.
I'm looking at the Oakland Raiders like,
yeah,
their defense finally coming along. We all know about the offense.
Yeah.
And the only thing that hindered the Oakland Raiders was the running game.
Yeah.
And what you saw with the running game did against the Denver Broncos, they didn't do too bad at all. So do not sleep on the Oakland Raiders. Like,
Oakland Raiders.
Just looking at Derek Carr from afar.
Yeah.
The man looked like he been had confidence. And he have two first-round receivers, which I think is the best duo on the perimeter more than anything. It's going to be on their running game.
Yeah, yeah.
If they can get hot in their running game,
yeah,
don't be surprised if you see the Oakland Raiders in the Super Bowl other than the New England Patriots.
You heard it here on the Ike Taylor Show on the internet. We're gonna get into that in another one of these shows. That's some interesting stuff. And you think about it, you know, you're right. Ben Roethlisberger, what, was a second-year starting quarterback? Ike Taylor was a first-year starting cornerback. Those are two really important positions, and they were starters on that Super Bowl team in 2005, 2006. So you sit down and think about it. They got Khalil Mack, who's a beast at linebacker. They got an unbelievable – you talk about Dallas' offensive line. They got big boy offensive line too. Like you said, it's going to come down to the running backs behind that line.
No question.
Yeah. Hey, let's wind this show up. Like, let's talk. We've been talking a lot about the Steelers, but they have what I call a must-win game on Sunday against Cleveland, which is 0-10, is looking to win a game, and it makes them a very dangerous opponent. Let's get your quick take on that game. How do you see it?
This game made me nervous, John. This game right here made me real nervous.
Yeah, I know.
Because Cleveland defense ain't as bad as what you think it is.
Yeah.
It's just when you have a defense who's on the field more than the offense, eventually you're going to figure it out.
Yeah.
And make plays on them. But from the get-go, they've been in a lot of games. They just can't finish them because the offense ain't popping on nothing.
Nope.
So their defense popping bottles. It's just they ain't able with them bottles to pay the piper. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
But yeah, at the same time, though, John, I'm telling you, please do not sleep on these Cleveland Browns. I'm more nervous in this game for the Pittsburgh Steelers against the Browns than any game. Hopefully, they'll prove me all the way wrong. Wow. But if you look at their front four / front seven, they got action.
Hey, your answer got me there. I don't even have a prediction, man. I'm just going to sit back in the cut and watch the game. I'm not going to spend any emotional anything in there. I'm just going to watch it. And I'm going to let your prediction carry this. So it sounds like you're saying Steelers with a question mark. And so I'm going to leave it. Yeah. You're picking the Steelers with a question mark.
Yeah, I'm picking the Steelers.
Yeah.
With a fat question mark.
Hey, dude, this was we done missed you. And you see why tonight on Ike Taylor Show, why we missed Ike Taylor. Ike, thank you so much. This was a great show. Hope our listeners enjoyed it. I know I enjoyed it. Want to thank everybody. Thank the airnetwork.net. We're going to be back with plenty more. Until next time, Ike, appreciate it, man.
All right, John. Have a good one, man.
All right, buddy.
All right. They let me know before I was famous. I had too much sauce. Out of my heel blow now. It's too much sauce. That's too much sauce. Got too much sauce. That's too much sauce. I got too much sauce. Protect the leak, the plain one. That's too much sauce. Got diamonds on all of my fingers. That's too much sauce. Yeah, all of my diamonds, they shine. Haters like, knock that off. Yeah, all of your diamonds are fake. Need to stop that, dog. Stop that, dog. You really kissing that girl like
she ain't tied me down. Oh my God. Shook your little nail with the haters, cause I'm blocking y'all.
Join us again for another edition of the Ike Taylor Show next week with the latest in Pittsburgh Steeler and NFL news. It's Ike Taylor along with John Harris exclusively on the airnetwork.net here on the Ike Taylor Show. Yeah.